My name is Wendi Montgomery Dial. I am one of the principal co-founders of the Oklahoma Liberty and Integrity Group. We started working on election integrity back after November 3rd, 4th of 2020. Okay. Ryan and I started separately, independently, and then we came together under a channel on Telegram called the America First Audits Channel. All 50 states were represented there, and we joined the administration of that channel for election integrity research. Now, Oklahoma Liberty Watch is an offshoot of that channel as well, okay? And Ryan and I were administrators on that channel. We decided to separate from the group because there's too much to do canvassing, too much to do legislation. There's only so many people and, you know, so many hands to go around. So we decided we would focus on data and we would also focus on legislation. Now, this is a disclaimer that we have put on the presentation. This abbreviated, we do have a longer presentation, by the way. I'm only supposed to speak for 30 minutes. Let's see if I can make it. Okay, this abbreviated presentation is based on OCLIG's work since November 4th, 2020, looking into the public information available on our elections in Oklahoma. We do not claim any expertise in the field of elections. Based upon all the anomalies we have found, we call for investigations into our elections by officials with subpoena power to collect and analyze more information than what we have access to. We make no accusation of wrongdoing on any individual person in this presentation. We would like answers and believe the citizens of Oklahoma deserve full transparency into our elections. Okay, so do y'all know who Daniel Webster is? Besides the fact that he wrote the dictionary, right? Okay. When you become entitled to exercise voting for public officers, let it be impressed on your mind that God commands you to choose for rulers, just men who will rule in the fear of God. The preservation of our government depends on the faithful discharge of this duty. If the citizens neglect their duty and place unprincipled men in office, the government will soon be corrupted. Laws will be made not for the public good so much as for selfish or local purposes. Corrupt or incompetent men will be appointed to execute the laws. The public revenues will be squandered on unworthy men, and the rights of the citizen will be violated and or disregarded. If our government fails to secure the public prosperity and happiness, it must be because the citizens neglect the divine commands and elect bad men to make and administer the laws. I think he was psychic. Okay, so why are we so focused on our elections? According to the Declaration of Independence, the founders stated the biblical truth that God gave man free will, and with that comes the right to choose their governing officials. Free and fair elections are vital to our freedom and to maintaining our God-given inherent rights. We focus on election integrity and are asking for investigations into our elections for these two of many reasons. Our purpose is to ensure our elected officials indeed hold office with our consent. The Declaration of Independence, the consent of the governed, is key. We wonder why in this God-fearing state are our officials so resistant to proving they have our consent to govern. Talk is cheap. It's beyond time for our officials to prove to us that our elections are free and fair. It is not up to us to prove they are not. There is enough evidence of irregularities to warrant multiple investigations into Oklahoma elections. So our Oklahoma elections at a glance. We have CTCL money, by the way, that went to half of our counties, in case you did not know. That is the Zuck Bucks. We have incomplete open records requests that we have submitted through OCLIG and also through Oklahoma Liberty Watch. Election integrity bills were killed in the 2021 legislative session. Instead, Oklahoma decided to join ERIC and passed a bill to keep information regarding the Hart Intercivic scanners from the public. In November of 2022, we had split ticket results in precincts, governor, lieutenant governor races, in a record GOP straight party voting year at 40%. Did you guys know that? In November of 2022, we had record straight party voting in Oklahoma. 40% of the GOP ballots were straight party tickets. Mine. Machines breaking down in Oklahoma County. Also, my precinct, as soon as I walked out the door from voting, I get a call, Wendy, the machine's down. I'm like, really? Not surprising. That happened all over Oklahoma County, by the way, in November of 2022. We had an increase of 8% registered voters over 2018, but 33,101 fewer votes cast in the governor's race. Does that make sense to anybody? What was going on in 2022 in the schools, critical race theory, all of the things that started to come to light, people going to their school board meetings? Do you think people were less upset or active than they were in 2018? Okay, so that does not make sense to me whatsoever. Okay, our voter registration rolls. What's the deal with our voter rolls? We have 207,000 registrations without an application date. Those should be purged. Small canvas in Oklahoma County documented problems with information at 60% of the addresses where they knocked on doors. There was a voter given credit for voting in a future election, and that has been documented. Okay. Absentee ballot requests from Wisconsin show up in a Logan County mailbox. That's that picture right there. I know that person, and he's got more than that. He has never lived in Wisconsin. His wife has never lived in Wisconsin. None of their kids have lived in Wisconsin. So they're trying to figure that one out. I say potentially, I don't know. The only thing we have in common with Wisconsin right now, as far as election goes, is that we are both in Eric. And I say in with air quotes, because according, if you ask our legislature, they did not fund our membership into Eric. They just joined. However, you know, pointing and clicking doesn't take much, right? All right, so we also had dead and multiple 100 plus year old voters voting. Legislators reporting issues with rolls on their door knocking campaigns. I've had two legislators show up at the last two presentations. Each one of them has said when they went out on their campaigns, they had issues with the voter rolls and their walk lists. So they're aware. There is a report included in a lawsuit filed in Georgia in August of 2019 that states that all digital voter registration lists are subject to malicious alteration. That is through the Securing the Vote, Protecting American Democracy. That's through the National Engineering, the National Association of Science, Engineering and Medicine et al. That is their publication. So, absentee ballot anomalies. Absentee ballot voting doubled in 2012 and again in 2016. Believe it or not, Democrats, by the way, now outvote Republicans 2-1 in absentee ballot voting in Oklahoma. We have approximately 65,000 absentee ballots unaccounted for in the 2020 election. We have approximately 65,000 voter registration cards returned to the Oklahoma County Election Board as of June 2022. We also have approximately 67,000 excess votes for Biden in 2020 in Oklahoma, according to one national expert in election integrity. Have y'all seen Seth Keschel?
Yes.
Okay. That's his research. There is an odd pattern of registration trends that do not follow the census pattern in Tulsa and Oklahoma counties, which correspond to a large percentage advantage in absentee and early voting for the Democratic Party. November of 2022, 33% of the counties didn't report initial absentee ballot numbers. There's also an odd pattern in the absentee and early vote totals per candidate from the primary in June of 2022, which makes absolutely no sense, given the tens of millions of ballot combinations possible in the entire election. Not all ballots are filled out completely. Some may only have one race marked. I was there for the Kevin Calvey recount in Oklahoma County. Did you guys hear about that? Okay, in Oklahoma County, the DA's race, Kevin Calvey, it was very close. He almost won outright in June, did not want to go to a runoff, so he decided to ask for a recount. Now, I was there as a member of Oklahoma Liberty and Integrity Group to watch and participate in that recount. Okay, so I will tell you that as the ballots went by my face, that I could see through the plastic and hear with the poor employees still wearing masks for whatever reason, okay? Not all of those ballots are uniform. Not everyone fills out every single race. There are ballots that are half full. There are ballots that only have one race marked. There are full ballots. But some people just decide, I don't know either, you know, either of these candidates, so I'm not gonna vote in that race, okay? So the fact that we have these uniform percentages across the board make absolutely no sense. This is your absentee plus your early vote totals divided by the total vote. That's what this number is, okay? Okay, so in 2020, Tulsa County, difference in mail-in versus election day performance, if you'll notice, we have a mirror situation going on here. Okay, so over here, Biden receives 29.92% of his total vote through mail-ins. Donald Trump, on the other hand, receives 29.45% less than he does on election day. Explain that, yeah. That's county after county, by the way. There's very little variance in between counties on this. And by the way, you should know, we're gonna go to the next slide. Donald Trump did not win a single county in 2020 through the absentee ballots in Oklahoma. Not a single one. In 2016, he won 5. This is the trend towards the absentee ballot use in the elections. Republicans used to have an advantage, guys, large advantage. It's gone. As a matter of fact, the Democrats are now 2-1 over Republicans in absentee ballots. Okay. Go ahead. Now the machines, this is very important. We're gonna get to the machines now. 2020 in Oklahoma, Trump won all 77 counties. That is the curve that comes up when we plot the data from the counties. This is the Trump versus Biden ratio. Now, if you'll notice, that's all 77 counties in Oklahoma, and you can plot a pretty smooth curve there. Yeah. I'm kind of looking for the scatter. I don't see any. The voting pattern in all 50 states and DC looks almost identical to the pattern of Oklahoma's 77 counties. That is Draza Smith's work on the bottom. That is all 50 states, including Oklahoma. Do you notice anything about those two curves? Okay, go on. That is the actual reporter ratio. No, you're good. Okay. So, what do you notice about these curves? Kind of the same, huh? On the top there, that is, let me read because I don't want to get this wrong. I would have to look on the computer.
2022 OKC mayoral race.
Yes, this is the 2022 OKC mayoral race on the bottom. Okay. That is the Norman mayoral race on the top. This is the Hoffmeister versus Stitt ratio in the election. So these are all Oklahoma elections, by the way, guys. We have no explanation as to why they all look like that. Go ahead. Okay, so now, June 21st, 2023, J. Alex Halderman writes, and this dropped out of a case in Georgia, by the way. It's Curling versus Raffensperger. The judge released a report It's called the Halderman Report. J. Alex Halderman is a computer scientist, and there is another computer scientist that studied the machines in the lawsuit was brought in 2019. I believe his research was done in 2021. And his report was sealed in 2021 by a judge in Georgia. She just released it, okay? It was given to one entity, though, by the way, you guys should know. He was allowed to share it with CISA, which is our cybersecurity unit for the Department of Homeland Security. They issued a report last June, in case you didn't hear, that basically warned all of the states that all of our machines, every single one of them, are compromisable. Last year, last summer, all of the machines across the country, compromisable. Their stance is they just haven't been compromised yet. Okay? CISA. Yes. Cybersecurity. Yes. Okay. Now, J. Alex Halderman writes, in 2023, June 21st, when this report is released, he decided to get out there and talk about it. So he says, our report explains how attackers could exploit the flaws we found to change votes or potentially even affect election outcomes in Georgia, including how they could defeat the technical and procedural protections the state has in place. While we are not aware of any evidence that the vulnerabilities have been exploited to change votes in past elections, without more precautions and mitigations, there's a serious risk that they will be exploited in the future. Okay, so underneath that is the explanation. The report was filed under seal on July 1st, 2021 and remained confidential until today. But last year, the court allowed us to share it with CISA, the arm of DHS responsible for election infrastructure, through the agency's Coordinated Vulnerability Disclosure Program. CISA released a security advisory in June 2022, confirming the vulnerability. Now, Dominion, to their credit, fixed those problems that came up in this report. They claim that they're fixed. However, Georgia Secretary of State Brad Raffensperger has been aware of our findings for nearly 2 years, but astonishingly, he recently announced that the state will not install Dominion's security update until after the 2024 presidential election, giving would-be adversaries another 18 months to develop and execute attacks that exploit the known vulnerable machines. Now, from the 96-page full report, part one entitled The Overview. I'm going to read these real fast and you can just let your draws just keep dropping, okay? Attacks could be implemented by malicious actors with very limited time and access to the machines. Principal findings are as follows. There are critical vulnerabilities that can be exploited to subvert all of its security mechanisms. That's all. Malicious software can be installed with temporary physical access or remotely from election management systems. Counterfeit tech cards can be made that can unlock the systems, allowing anyone with physical access to install malware. Using root privileges, attackers could exploit the election definitions file and spread malware to all counties and across an entire state. Audit logs can be altered simply by opening them to the text editor application. Vote stealing malware can be installed remotely from the EMS by altering the election definition file. Likely more vulnerabilities in the software that couldn't be determined in this study. He says he just didn't have time, but he had a million more. That's an exaggeration, I'm sorry. Several more tests that he could have run on the machines. Now, the main conclusions of the report, the Dominion machines in Georgia were not sufficiently secured against technical compromise to withstand vote-altering attacks by bad actors who are likely to attack future elections in Georgia. These adversaries include foreign actors and domestic political actors. Why is that? Because there were lawsuits across the country where people were asking to examine the machines. The machines could be compromised to the same extent and as or even more easily than the machines they replaced. As a matter of fact, the vulnerabilities are even easier to exploit than on the old systems. He tested computers, voting machines, 10 years ago. 10 years previous. He expected those vulnerabilities that he found to be solved. Not only were they not solved, they were worse 10 years later. Despite the addition of a paper trail, the malware can still change individual votes with most election outcomes without detection. Even the most risk-limiting audit can only assess the election outcome, not whether individual votes were counted as intended. Okay? When hand-marked paper ballots are used with appropriate precautions in a risk-limiting audit, they can provide high confidence that the individual votes are counted as cast. Well, here's the problem. What if your ballots aren't valid ballots? What if you're counting real money and monopoly money? Okay, now that's a problem. You have to make sure that all of your ballots are legitimate in order for that to work. He also states that no grand conspiracies would be necessary to commit large-scale fraud, but rather only moderate technical skills of the kind that attackers who are likely to attack Georgia elections already possess. These vulnerabilities can be used by partisan actors to cast doubt on election results and suppress voter participation and cast doubt on the legitimacy of the election results. So he says, it's no grand conspiracy to think that perhaps there's issues with widespread voter fraud, or it's at least has the potential to occur with these machines. Now, I will tell you how this applies to Oklahoma, or potentially applies to Oklahoma. We need people to look into this, and they're not doing it. And I don't know why. I don't know why after CISA's report came out last summer that we voted on machines in November. I do not understand that. Because Oklahoma's election software is unique to Oklahoma. The manufacturer of the machines, Hart InterCivic, wrote it especially for the state. Oklahoma's election system is statewide, planned for after HAVA passed, that's the Help America Vote Act. To be implemented in 2006, controlled at the state level and set up like a wheel. And that's why I have the Ferris wheel in the background there to give you a picture. With a main device in the center and the county election machines hardwired as hubs, precinct machines add to the system. All are programmed using MVDs, or in layman terms, thumb drives. The MVDs store the counts on each precinct machine and are plugged into the county election machines on election night after the polls close. During the evening, the state machine scans all 77 counties' machines, those main machines in your county election board, looking for the results being entered in through the MVDs to the county machines. Absentee ballot counts are stored on MVDs if counted early and stored, as are the early vote totals in the county election board vault. So those MVDs are removable from the system. You take them out, you put them in the vault. Okay. Then you take them out the next day if you have early voting the next day and you put them back in. But they are under lock and key, just so you guys know this is Oklahoma County. No one can access the counts before 7 p.m. on election night, and then only the state machine has access to the county machines via the hard wire. That state machine is hardwired to all 77 counties. Now, potentially, any malware that's on that state machine would be transmitted to the county machines. Any malware that's on a county machine could be transferred to the state machine. Any malware that's on an MVD that's at a precinct machine is installed on the county, right? So you take the MVD out, you put it in at the county, you know. This is how the potential, you know, for malware being in our system happens. Okay. Now we don't need wireless connections for this to happen. Okay. Now, the thumb drives are sent to the counties by the state election board. That's from someone I know who used to work on the machines in Oklahoma County. The origin is the state election board or our election software vendor. They send the counties the MVDs. So it's either state election board or Hart InterCivic. Okay. So you guys at your county level, you're doing everything you need to do, right? State election board, doing everything they need to do. We don't know where the issue's potentially coming in from the system. We just know the potential is obviously there. Computer experts, am I a computer software expert? No, are you? No. Yes, someone's nodding their head and saying yes. Okay, now here's the thing though. If he were to pull up the election software off of these machines and throw it up here on the screen, he would have to explain to me, and it's a foreign language to me, he would have to explain to me what that software says, and I would have to believe him or not. I could not double check. I have no idea if what he's telling me is accurate or not. These are my elections. These are my officials that are making my laws. I want to be able to verify for myself, not have to rely on somebody else to tell me, but verify for myself that the counts are correct and that the officials that are sitting as my public servants are there through the consent of the body politic, my neighbors, my friends, fellow citizens, right? Okay, like I said, I would not be able to do that. Do you guys know why children were taught to read back in the day? And when I say the day, I mean the 1700s, 1600s. Do you know why the charity schools in Scotland started to teach the children to read with the Presbyterian ministers? All of the kids. To read the Bible. Why were they taught to read the Bible? So that they would not have to rely on anyone else to tell them what it said. I do not want to have to rely on a computer software expert to tell me what those machines are doing. Our elections right now, the machines are black box machines. I don't know what they're doing. I don't know what they're doing on the inside. I don't know if they're infected with malware. I can't even tell that. It's neither here nor there to me whether or not they are. What is here and there for me is that I can't determine that for myself. The only way for me to do this is paper, pen, hand-counted ballots at the precinct level. I can watch somebody count. I know how to count. I could run that count, okay? So most people with a fifth grade education could run that count, right? Okay, so that's kind of what we're looking for here. Given the explanation in previous slides, there are multiple ways the system can be compromised, even though it's hardwired and self-contained. The machines are updated and programmed as well as tested away from the public, potentially a violation of HAVA, before every election using these thumb drives, which are unique to the precinct machine and come to the counties labeled. It is indeed possible that no person in Oklahoma, including the people who maintain the machines, would be wiser if the thumb drives had malware installed on them, unless they were looking for it. Okay. So these are my sources. All right. The original research here was conducted by myself and Ryan Hill. He is my the other principal co-founder of Oklahoma Liberty and Integrity Group. Other researchers, Oklahoma Liberty Watch, Draza Smith, Captain Seth Keschel. Other sources cited, State of Oklahoma Plan for Implementation to Help America Vote Act of 2002, Senate Select Committee on Intelligence report on election interference, you know, when they were looking into the Russia thing. Okay. National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine, Securing the Vote, Protecting American Democracy. CISA Advisory, J. Alex Halderman, the Oklahoma State Election Board, and the Oklahoma County Election Board. Okay, so this is our website, oklig.org. We have an election integrity toolkit up there. I do advise you guys, before every election, go in and check your voter history. Make sure it's accurate. Make sure you have not inadvertently changed parties or something without your knowledge. We've had that reported to us as having happened. I also have a voter registration card, by the way, that I kept at my house of a woman who has not lived in my house for probably at least 10 years or more. We bought that house 2 years ago and she and her husband divorced. I have that in my mailbox from last year. Okay, now do we require photo ID to vote in Oklahoma? No. What could happen? What could I do if I were so inclined? I could vote for her, or I could give it to anyone who is a woman, and they could go and vote in my election. I've heard people tell me, too, there have been, like, someone got four or five of these in their mailbox of people that, you know, are registered to vote at their address. They don't know who they are. Okay. The voter rolls need to be cleaned up. I never present a problem without presenting a solution. The solution for the voter rolls, in my humble opinion, they are so messed up at this point. Archive them, re-register every Oklahoman to vote. That will clean them up immediately, like that. Okay. Yes, sir.
Consequences, like in Brazil, they got totally really picked off of all machines, and the Supreme Court controlled the elections down there. So the last election, they sprung Lula, who was an avowed communist who embezzled billions of dollars for oil companies. They put him on the ballot, and he defeated Bolsonaro handily because they rigged everything, and there's no way to contest it because it's all restricted machines. Mm-hmm. And then the good news is we have a little county in Missouri called Osage County, and there they went to all paper ballots, and they were able to count the judges there and do the election faster than what the machines could do.
It's amazing. I can attest to this fact. It's amazing what a bunch of PTO moms can do, like in 3 hours in an afternoon, triple count money accurately, and have the conversation we're having at the same time and get it done and done quickly. I was a PTO officer and a PTO mom for years. I also, by the way, just so you know, my educational background, I do have a Bachelor of Science degree in geology from University of Texas, El Paso. I minored in physics, but this is not that kind of math. Okay, this is pretty simple math as far as the absentee ballots go. That curve that's happening in our elections on election day in the machine, I cannot explain that. And that would take someone who is a mathematical genius to explain it to me, okay? So anyway, also, like I said, I do not like to present problems without presenting potential solutions. And someone else is here tonight that's going to help us try to figure out number two on my list of priorities when it comes to elections and election integrity, and that is getting rid of the machines, but also anything else that ails the counties. Now here's the thing, and he's going to explain this to you, but I want to say I'm fully on board with his philosophy of this approach. It has to be done in Christian love, coming from a place of God. Because our officials, we love them in Oklahoma, right? We love our officials. We love all of our elected officials, the people that serve us. We want to come to them in love with these problems and say, fix it, investigate it, solve it. Don't do this, don't do that. It's going to hurt us, right? Okay, so I am fully on board with Jaron's approach. And I just wanted to make that clear because he's going to speak after me. Any other questions?
I have a comment.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, Oklahoma has the best elections in the country. According to the Center for American Progress and their report in 2018, we get a C. So our elections get a C in 2018. Other states get a B. Nobody gets an A.
These were A plus.
Well, Montana, the citizens of Montana investigating election integrity have been told the same thing. Their elections are the best in the country. Yes.
I think one of the biggest problems that we've got is vote fraud. So when we have the Medicaid expansion, I am certain that the Democrats went door to door with notaries and collected ballots in certain parts of Oklahoma City, which is supposed to be illegal. And how do you fight that? I mean,
I asked about the nursing home situation, and in 2020, there was an emergency declared in the state which allowed our Secretary of the Election Board to write emergency rules for that election. Nursing homes were a special issue because people were not allowing the residents out, or they weren't getting out, right? They were pretty much locked down. A lot of people couldn't go see their elderly parents. I mean, this distressed me a lot during 2020, right? The nursing home situation. Now, people were sent into the nursing homes. This is the thing you need to know. County by county in Oklahoma, your election board can actually, according to a rule, in certain nursing homes, go in and collect the ballots in a locked box and then bring it back to the election board, and that is usually an election board official. I am not sure what your county did for 2020. You would have to ask your election board about that. Now, I do know in Oklahoma County, they sent people out, and it was people that were employed with the county election board in Oklahoma that went out to the nursing homes, yes. They worked really late.
I'm talking about going door to door.
Door to door.
You get a mail-in ballot.
Mm-hmm.
You need to fill it out right now, and we've got somebody who can endorse it.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll make sure that you vote the right way.
Mm.
And
that sounds like vote chasing.
Have you ever heard of a Republican community organizer? I never have, but what was Barack Obama? He was a community organizer in Chicago. Do you know what community organizers do?
Mm-hmm.
They make sure people vote the right way.
Mm.
And they get paid money.
I am originally from Illinois. We know all about community organizing and political corruption.
Yes.
And the mob. And yes.
And we've got, don't tell me we don't have that in Oklahoma.
Well, now what y'all need to understand about vote chasing, it is perfectly legal in Oklahoma, and the GOP is talking about doing that this year. That is where you contact voters, make sure they got their ballot, talk to them about filling it out, and then talk to them about turning it in, and you contact them over and over and over again, and you bother them until they turn that vote in. Okay, so as long as they are not picking up that ballot physically at that address and taking it somewhere for that person, it's not harvesting, it's vote chasing. As long as that person is mailing in their own ballot, that's actually legal.
And it's absurd. That's what democracy devolves into. Why our forefathers hated it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, well, one of the things that we can do as well to clean up the elections is to restrict absentee ballot voting again.
Yes.
No more no excuse ballots. No more no excuse absentee ballots. You either have to be in the military or an invalid veteran to your home. You know, if you can get out and go to the store, you can get out once every 4 years and vote, or once every 2 years and vote. If you want to vote for president, or if you want to vote in every election and vote for your congressional officials, then yes.
You should be able to vote absentee in person if you're going to be out of town. There should be extenuating circumstances, but to say nobody's going to mail out absentee ballots.
Mm-hmm. We have restrictions. We have a few. Yeah, and the thing about it is in order to make sure that our elections are secure, the fewer excuses we have, the better off we are as far as absentee balloting goes.
But if your Democrats are going to tell you that that's racist, but their poor constituents can't figure out how to get people.
That doesn't make logical sense. That's never made logical sense to me. And if people actually allow people to tell them that, and they actually take that into consideration and kind of care about that, that is not something I care about. So people can call me all kinds of things. They can call me all kinds of words. They can call me all kinds of names. They can put motivations on my head that I know I do not have. I literally do not care because it's, number one, a logical fallacy. Number two, I know it's not true. And number three, common sense has to dictate and come into place somewhere, right? So common sense, I have a lot of it. Yes, ma'am. I do not, because we put out open records requests to all 77 counties for the cast vote records. Didn't get any. Okay. Didn't get any. They were denied by the state election board. They were denied by the state election board. Also in 2021, I didn't, you know, when I said they passed a law that hid information and hid information on the machines from us, okay, that's one of the things that they say falls under that new law. It falls under the purview of the machines. Their cybersecurity people say that can be used potentially to interfere with elections. So that is not information that they are required to give us anymore. That was the reply from county after county after county. It was like it was Xeroxed and sent out. Yes. There are groups in the state, and I agree with this as well, there are groups in the state that are trying to get all of our elections held in November. All during the general election time, so that we don't have like mayoral races in April, or we don't have school board races in February that nobody hears about, bond races. The county election board, yes, the county election board should probably be sending out that information. Yes, and we do have groups that are working on voter information. Gaylene Stupik, actually, out of Oklahoma County. I know she is working on a voter information program.
I know lots of the different groups are working on it, but mm-hmm. I think that should be something standard
that somebody can fill out. Right. That, yeah, I agree. That would be a good thing. Definitely a good thing to have.
Where did you get it about not showing the ID that they had to back yourself in your
number? I'm sorry?
You made a comment.
Yeah, you don't. You show a registration card or a driver's license.
Registration card, or you have to have an official government issued ID. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Right. Yes, so I could give that voter registration card for the woman who lived at my address to any woman, and she doesn't have to show a driver's license or a picture ID. She just shows that registration card. That's why that's a problem. Yeah, there's no picture ID that's required, and we need to change that as well.